As a small business owner, you deserve more. More confidence, more connectivity, more of the tools that help your business thrive. And at Cox Business, you can expect more from us. We don't just have sales reps. We have perfect plan identifiers, people who will work with you to make sure your business gets everything it needs and nothing that it doesn't. Your business deserves more, and that's why you can expect more from Cox Business. Call 800-526-8572 to switch today.
There's nothing more predictable in life than the unexpected. Lightning will always strike. Hail will fall on roofs. Fortunately, there's AAA. AAA has been helping members stay prepared for over 100 years. So when unusual storms, fallen debris, or sudden leaks happen, you'll be covered. Check, check, and check. Get the home and auto insurance you need by talking with a AAA insurance agent today. Visit AAA.com/insurance or stop by your local AAA store.
If you prefer real mornings, shouldn't you have a real breakfast? At McDonald's, we get real about breakfast. That's why you can have a savory sausage biscuit with delicious hash browns for only $1.50. It's time to wake up breakfast. Single item at regular price. Prices and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Thoughts of suicide may feel impossible to overcome. But with help and support, you can find hope and meaning. Call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline at 1-800-273-TALK to speak to a counselor or visit suicidepreventionlifeline.org. It's free, it's confidential, it's available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And even if it feels like it, you are not alone.
Howdy, everybody.
There you go. You're coming through. All right. This is Chick Chat. I did it right that time. And I have my
cool
buddy, Aggie and Auntie, or as I like to call her. Oh,
hello, friends.
I'm trying to make VOD happen. Right? I'm trying to make VOD happen, and nobody else.
This is very choppy. Are we all here?
Yeah,
I think we're all here.
It's not choppy on my end, sweetie.
Yeah,
we're here. No, we're not. You're the
okay,
one
cool.
Have a technical difficulty.
No,
sweetie.
It's all good now.
It's always something. It's always something.
You even sound good on the speakers, so I don't know what to
Super.
Tell you. Yeah, I don't know. Mine, I'm kind of low, so I don't know. Let me figure out what's up with that. So, yeah, it's the same old on live radio. We are, debating about what we're going to talk about tonight. We had quite the discussion. I think that Well, I'll just say, to start off, that I am about 6 inches above my eyeballs when it comes to Twitter right now. I've had it with, except for, you know, present company excluded, I have completely had it with Twitter. And if
there's so many morons.
Well, people are literally so, and I mean, okay, people are always nasty on Twitter, but people are so nasty right now that it is literally making me sick at my stomach.
Yeah. I mean, people are acting like they're caged animals right now.
Well, because they are, I mean.
Because we are, exactly. Yeah. Right now, we're still stuck at home. There is not much for us to do. We don't have any outlets for any of the bad feelings that we may have towards anything. And it keeps bottling up. It's like a pressure cooker. And so people are just, Twitter is one of the only things available to a lot of people where they can just let loose. And unfortunately, it's gotten really bad.
Oh, so cancerous on its face. Like on a good day, it's cancer.
So it's a matter of can't take it out on anybody else, so I'm going to take it out on strangers on Twitter.
And then you get the party van, so yeah.
It is, yeah. And you're right, it is, you know, that certain level of anonymity actually gives like a safety blanket to people, so when they strike out, they feel that they have that safety blanket that protects them from anything that the other person may feel or say.
Doesn't I don't really get that in my people. Opinion. Yeah, I don't understand people who have that dichotomy of being a complete douche to people because they're anonymous. Like, I'm anonymous because, well, I'm a weirdo, but I would not say something to somebody on Twitter or any social media that I wouldn't probably say to them to their face. I don't get that mean, shitty. It's like, who hurt you? Tell us on the doll.
Right. Show me on the doll where Twitter hurt you.
I had somebody actually on another social media. They were very hostile to me because of politics, which I'm very loath to get involved into, but for some reason I was in this group, and they were extremely hostile over my political stance at the time. And not a week later, I see them over at the grocery store and they're acting like everything is fine and how am I and
hey,
you
know, girl,
missing you and blah, 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 and all this stuff. And I'm going, you literally called me a bitch not a week ago online because of my political stance, and you're acting like, you know, nothing happened. And I was like, I was very distant, you know, I just kept distant with her. And after that, and I haven't spoken to her much since, but, and this was several years ago, but it's, to me, it really is kind of weird to have somebody act one way on Twitter. And then when you meet and if you know them in real life, they act totally different. It's really strange.
That is bizarre. I'm glad I don't have to deal with that. I don't get that. Because you talk smack online, and like, if you have to run into people, if I had to run into people, actually, it doesn't matter. But if I had to run into people that I talk to on Twitter, I'd be actually pretty psyched, because I'm the same person on Twitter as you would meet in real life. I don't really get why. I guess I get it. People have their problems or whatever, but why not just be authentic? You know what I mean? Oh, you're a tough guy on the internet. Why don't you just show your true self? You know?
Yeah, so much of it is so fake in so many ways. And I mean, you know, that's, you guys, I don't know if you know this about me, but Aggie knows this about me. That's, you know, fake Twitter is something that I track and keep up with. But, you know, besides that, it's just the level of nasty. Is it literally making me nauseous? I have a Twitter flu. Everybody else has coronavirus. I have Twitter flu.
That's a good description for it. Yeah.
I really, because I just came up with that like just right now. Is that pretty good? You like that?
I like that.
I like it. That all right? It is very fitting.
I got Twitteritis.
The blog button, like if people speak a certain way, then I know that, and I'm not like, oh, I wouldn't rescue you from a burning car. I just know that you have certain preconceived notions and we wouldn't even be able to sort of negotiate that out or speak civilly. And I don't want to be bothered with that. So I'm just like, blockity, blockity, block. And also I'm like, you're going to report me with your gang stalker friends and fuck you. So out.
Civil. Yeah. Twitter and civil are not two things that go together.
No, not really.
At all. So I need to relax. Aggie, do you have some ideas about how I might be able to relax?
Well, it really depends on the person. I know some people that relax by taking a knife and like dulling the blade on a piece of wood. I'm not saying who. She might be sitting with us. I'm not saying who. But I mean, it really depends on.
It's not me.
Why would you dull a knife? I'd rather be sitting there with a whetstone, like.
I know. Mm-hmm. But there's several things that a lot of people can do. One of the best things that I always recommend to people, regardless of their physical ability, is yoga, because yoga actually teaches you breathing coping mechanisms, and that helps with stress levels a lot.
And trying to balance on one foot, right?
It forces you to concentrate into doing things that normally you would not
so
do.
Relaxing, trying to balance on your hands with your knees on your elbows and falling over on your head a half a dozen times.
That you don't even have to try the crow
position. I can't
Twitter
when you're doing this, so it works.
Yeah.
No, with yoga, though, what Aggie's saying, you don't have to do the crow position or whatever, but if you get really quiet and you're going through the motions of even the simplest poses, and you're just, not to sound like a giant smelly hippie, but if you're being mindful with it and you're just with yourself in your house, in your room, whatever, you don't really have a choice but to find your center and you're breathing and you don't have the TV on, your internet, like you're just putting your body in different positions. They don't have to be the advanced ones where you're going to fall over and break something.
Like I said, it can be beginners and you do not have to move into more intermediate or advanced.
I'm sorry, but I just have to say this because Vod just totally Karen to my joke.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I told a joke and you Karen'd it.
I didn't mean to Karen it.
Nobody invited you, Karen. Where is my friend Vod? Because nobody asked Karen to come to this party.
I fucking broke a hip doing the crow pose the other day. For fuck's sake. Is that better?
That's my
Vod.
Did I
get it?
That is who I invited to my party. That girl right there.
Yes. Fucking crow pose, am I right? Like I need more stretch marks.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with stretch marks.
Oh, all right. Chicks, now you're caring.
You know what? You know the whole saying about chicks digging scars? Well, guys kind of dig stretch marks too, so there's that.
No, I don't know that they really
do. Look, let me live my fantasy.
Oh, I mean, Mr. Vodka, I don't even have a belly button anymore. That's how many fucking scars I have. And I got to tell you, I do kind of miss having a belly button. The picture of Gillum, I'm a little bit jealous. Even though he has a big, giant walnut belly button, I'm like, at least you still have a belly button, you son of a bitch. That's a thing I never told you guys. Hey,
no, I don't care. Yeah, I can't. I'm already sad enough. I can't because people, you know, we talked about this already in the first part of the show. People on Twitter making me sad. I can't hear about your non-belly button. Like, can we tell
Imagine
that story on another show?
We'll have to tell that story.
I can't mourn your belly button right now.
We don't have to mourn it. It's just, it is what it is. I might get a tattoo, a keyhole, or a USB port, like, to have something there. but it's gone. I would totally do the
U.S. paperwork. I would totally do that. If it was me, I'd have a U.S. or the European
plug or the 220 volt American. Like, I don't know. Yeah. I got a lot of options. I'm still thinking about it.
Yeah, that sounds really interesting.
I can't believe I just told our whole audience.
Oh, I can.
About me.
I totally can. It's like, it's another thing that just goes with live radio.
All 15 of our listeners.
You say things that you never meant to say, and then you're like, oh shit, did I just say that? Yep, you did. You said it.
You did.
You told the audience.
And it's okay.
Yeah, that's fine. They're not judging you. All right, so yoga, which we've decided, pretty much Shavasana or anything else is just going to be frustrating, right? So,
as long as you do simple poses. I'm really good about the whole yoga thing. And you don't have to do it, you know, doing it for like maybe 10, 15 minutes, even if it's just sitting there breathing, you know, in and out. That will relieve your stress. And what a lot of people, I know this is going to sound corny, and this is my nickname on Twitter. If you ever see me being referred to as Pollyanna, but I love that movie for one reason and one reason only. She always...
What movie?
Pollyanna.
Oh.
Yeah. And I learned a big lesson in that movie. She always found a reason to be glad. And I always do. I always find something to be happy about every day. I don't have to be happy all day. Because if I were happy all day, I'd probably snap and end up on forensic files.
That's like that's how you get through the day. I'm actually the same way. Like, everything that doesn't kill you doesn't kill you. So your every day above ground is a good one. Just, you got to find the bright spot.
Yeah, that's my dad's answer. And when you ask him, how you doing, Dad? I'm still above ground.
Yep.
Yeah, my dad.
My dad's the same way. He's like, another day. This is good. I'm jazzed. I have conquered sleep and I'm alive. That's the way my dad looks at it. So it drives my mom.
You guys are lucky because my dad's always like, it's been like 6 months. We got to have the chat about how I'm going to die and where all my stuff is and the will.
You've been lifting
weights for 40 years. You're going to outlive us all.
Right? But my dad had that talk with all of us. He made us all fill out a piece of paper with the stuff that we wanted so that he could put it in the will. Mm-hmm. He's already, you know, he updates his will every 2 years. He goes and has his checkup every 6 months. He keeps us updated as to the status of his death. So,
oh, geez. I'm the only one of us that my dad has that conversation with. I don't know why. My dad has that conversation with. I'm the only one. There's three girls in my family, and I'm the only one that he talks to about stuff like that. I don't know why. I don't know why I'm the lucky one, right? Middle girl, you know, middle child. We always get screwed one way or another or in every way.
I think for the same reason that I am. The other one's just, oh, Dad, we don't want to hear that. You know, you have a long day, blah, 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 and you're more of a realist.
Right.
And I think
You guys should try being the only child and having a dad that's like the Jack LaLanne guy. I'm serious. He's 70-something years old. He could absolutely kick Schwarzenegger's ass. He's been lifting weights forever. He's ripped the tits. And he's like, oh, well, you know, because I'm going to die. I'm like, you're not dying anytime soon.
The devil couldn't kill you, man.
Honestly, the epitome of like, clean eating, that's been his whole life goal, is lifting weights and clean eating. He's ridiculous. That guy who was 95 who was like, I can still break a walnut with my traps. I'm like, I get it. I'm just like, tell me where the stash of guns is, because that's all I'm really interested in. The rest of it, I know. It's all mine. I get it. I'm an only child, whatever. Tell me where that sweet, sweet Thompson, whatever the hell gun is, because I'm going for those. And the crossbow, too.
I hear. No, it's like, there. So my dad is like the guns. Okay, I get all the guns, right, Dad? Yeah, except for one. One he's given to his best friend, and I'm like, okay, yeah.
That's cool.
But it's the baddest one. It's the Henry rifle. It's the Henry rifle, of course, right?
So I'm like, which caliber?
Yeah. You know what? I don't remember. It's a badass rifle with the scope, though. I don't remember exactly which one it is because I don't get it when he dies anyway.
I love my Henry.
It's going to his best friend, who I will say deserves it, and will probably use it more than I would, and will probably give me deer meat if I tell him I want it. So it's all good.
Well, my dad's leaving me old books and the stuff that most of my sisters and my brother would look at me like, of course you would want that crap.
You know, of course you would want that stupid stuff.
But, you know, when my grandmother passed away, my mom and dad had to go through her house and clean it out and divide stuff to go to relatives and stuff like that. And my dad said, what is it that you want? I know that there was stuff here that you wanted. And I said, there are two things that I want. One was a light fixture, and the other one was a book that was written by his uncle, who was apparently a very famous historian and writer from my tiny little island. And my dad was like, I can't believe you even know that book exists. And I said, I used to read that book when I was five. I would sit there and try to understand, because it's not a kid's book, but I was just fascinated that my last name was on this book, and ergo, this person related to me, so I had to read this book, right? And so he brought that back, and my sisters were like, why did you want that book? I was like, they don't have the same connection to ancestry that I do. So
isn't that lovely, though? Like, you want something that is meaningful, that you have a connection with.
Yeah.
That isn't a thing where you're like, oh, I'm going to sell it on eBay or whatever. I'm the same way.
And my parents have a first edition in Spanish of La Russa's Gastronomique. And I'm like, I want that book. And my sister's like, why? It's like falling apart and like stained with food and all this stuff. And I'm going, are you kidding me? What do you mean? Why? It's like, it drives me crazy.
You know,
but then I win because nobody wants the stuff that I want. So I don't have to fight anybody for it. They're still fighting over my dad's lamp, which I'm like, you know, that I got him that lamp at Target.
I've seen entire families disintegrate over a bedroom set.
I
have to tell you, thank God I'm an only child. Like, I don't have to fight with anyone when baby Jesus calls my parents home and whatever. Thank God. Because it's so disgusting what happens with a bedroom set. You're not going to talk to your brother or sister ever again because of a bedroom set. People are insane. Really
weird. My ex's family was like that, and it was so friggin' stupid. So, what else? This is not relaxing, though. What else can we do to relax? I need to relax, Aggie.
We have a saying, and Annie Popkin knows a saying, idle hands are the devil's work.
They are.
Right?
I mean, not for me, but for the rest of you, probably.
Yeah, and I've always found that finding something that occupies your hands, if you don't have to put a lot of thought into it, it could be something automatic like cross-stitching or knitting, crocheting, sewing. Anything that occupies your hands will actually force your body to
But
relax.
We don't recommend Twitter.
And for the dudes out there,
but not typing. Like, unless you're writing a novel, in which case you can do that.
Go rake the yard, go chop some wood, go like, yeah, it's not, I've had to learn this way before this whole, everybody has to stay home shit. I've had to learn how to cope with bullshit. Sometimes, though, I will tell you, it's okay if you just need to shut off, if you need to just unplug, sit on the couch, no one's home, watch some TV or read something, whatever, read a book, watch TV, just do nothing. It's a thing that doesn't get a lot of appreciation or play because everybody's like, oh, you're sitting around doing nothing. You know what? Sometimes you need to sit around and do fuck all and nothing. That's what your soul needs. Or take a bath, scrub your feet, you know, whatever. Clean a bathroom. I don't know. Order a new mop. That actually makes me really happy.
Yeah, cleaning does not relax me at all. However, vegging out and like watching something stupid on TV, that will usually relax me.
My auditory visual Xanax is HGTV. I can't tell you how many times I've been like, thank you, baby Jesus, for HGTV. Their commercials are not political. They have carried me all the way through the last 5 years and then some. I can't even tell you how much I love HGTV.
I totally agree with you.
You know?
Absolutely.
I have to third it. And
the flea market flip is fantastic. That broad, I'm so jealous of her amazing body. And they take you know, Aggie.
What?
They take shitty shit and refurnish it, and it's like amazing.
What not to wear?
Oh my word, that show.
I love that show.
Wait, that's not still on though.
Yes, it is.
No, it's
still
not.
On.
Yes, it is.
Is it reruns?
No.
I'm pretty sure. I saw
they're making new ones?
Yes. The last time I saw it, they took a Wiccan, right? Who dressed in like a witch costume all the time, every day, everywhere she went, she was dressed like a witch.
Okay, I love that show, but I haven't seen a new episode of that in probably 5. So it might be in syndicate. Stacey London, I adore her. And the other one, I forget who the guy was, but they were amazing.
Clayton, his name is Clayton. I can't remember his last name.
I love that.
But I think they're still making them. I'm pretty sure this was like a recent episode. So
I'm going to look it up.
Yeah, you might want to look again. Because at any rate,
old episodes are fine.
Well, they made
like
millions of them. It's not like you could have possibly seen all of them anyway. And even if you did, I mean, you know, it's still...
Oh my
informative God. Stuff. That is, but that's one of my veg out shows. I can totally veg out for that show.
It just came back this year.
Yeah.
What Not to Wear, being revived by TLC, returning in 2020. Oh my God.
Oh, another one that returned was Trading Spaces. That one returned too.
I will watch the same episodes of any show on HGTV.
All right. Well, it's time to go to a break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about something different. So, if we just totally like, if all the guys in the chat room totally got turned off by that,
we're not catering to guys, we're catering to people. They can love this too.
Okay, Karen, we'll be right back.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm. But even then, he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
All right, we're back, and I think that Aggie has something that she wants to, for lack of a better word, let's just say bitch about a little bit.
Yes, welcome to the bitching half of the show.
Because the first half of the show wasn't that at all.
No,
but it's relatable.
No, no.
We're not like, you didn't take the garbage out, huh, Kyle? We're not bitching about guys.
We're not
We're
not
guys,
nagging.
We love you. No.
No, it was something that really bothered me. I saw my sister. She had posted something on that the Book of Faces, let's just say it.
Ew.
And, you know, she sends me the picture, and it's her senior picture with the cap and gown and smiling. And, yeah, my sister was... It's still pretty hot. You know, she's real pretty and everything. And the caption was something along the lines of, post your, in support of seniors that won't be able to walk through commencement, post your senior picture, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I'm going, why the fuck would that support seniors? I just don't get it. Doesn't it make them feel worse? Because they will not be able to
It
do
would
so.
Be. They've already missed their friggin' proms.
Yes, I mean, they're missing
it would
so
mean,
much.
Yeah.
I mean, all of the baseball was gone. The basketball was gone. Everything. I mean, sporting event, your prom, your end of year banquets for whatever groups you're in. I know that I was National Honor Society president, and we had an end of the year banquet where, you know, the new president was chosen and all that stuff and whatnot. And I was in Mu Alpha Theta. It was all the geek clubs. Okay, yeah, true. But we all had all banquets at the end of the year. Now we can't have that.
I was trying to remember.
You know, they won't be able to walk across the stage. They're not going to be able to do any of the things that we as seniors, when we were that age, got to enjoy.
Well, senior,
it's a big, giant ripoff.
We had senior parties, right? So, you know, I had, like, my mom and dad were friends with everybody. So I had, like, seven senior parties, and some of them were for like big groups of people and a couple of my family, they gave just for me. And so we would have missed all the senior parties. We would have missed prom. We would have missed banquets. We would have missed baseball, softball, all the spring sports. We would, I mean, there's a lot in graduation. And then the party after graduation. And then the trip, the senior trip. You know, which
no matter what we went through, for any of us of any age, no matter what we went through in our school years, in terms of, like, someone mentioned on Twitter at some point, well, we used to have to sit there and do duck and cover drills and get under our desks.
Okay, boomer. Worried about
nuclear. Well, I mean, I'm a Gen Xer, but they were like,
yeah, but we didn't duck and cover drills. Like, right, I never, well, and I grew up right smack dab in the middle of one of the largest Army bases and the largest Air Force bases in the country, and I never did a friggin' duck and cover drill, once.
I remember being in high school and having the, you know, looming specter of a nuclear annihilation kind of being a thing. I mean,
they talked about it. They had that stupid made-for-television Day After movie when we were in school too. But
right,
My mother always talked about duck and cover drills and stuff like that. We never did them in school, right? Because at that point, they had figured out that atomic bombs had gotten to the point, and everybody had figured out that if they hit Fort Benning and they hit Warner Robins, they hit Robins Air Force Base, which is most likely two of the top targets that they were going to hit in this country, we were all gone. Like, ducking, it was not going to do us any good whatsoever to do a duck and cover drill.
Well,
we wouldn't have time to get under our desks.
When I was still in elementary school, I was still in Puerto Rico. And let's face it, Puerto Rico is really behind the times when I was growing up. I mean, my hometown where I lived, in the area that I lived, did not get telephone service until 1995. That's how remote we were. But we still did the duck and cover from books that were mandated in our school system that were printed back in the 50s. And this was back in the early 70s.
Wow.
You know? Okay. So
yeah, we never did them. But
we did that. We didn't understand it. We didn't know what we were doing. And nobody fit under the desk because it wasn't, you know, the flat desk. It was the single seater desk and everything. And I'm like, well, this doesn't do anything. Why are we under here?
We never did them. But you can quite literally triangulate my town equal distance from Robins Air Force Base and Fort Benning. So we were not.
Are you here where back in, I think, the 50s? They were flying a nuke somewhere, and oops, it fell out of the plane.
That's the Savannah River. No, that's way east of us. Yeah, no, that and that nuke is supposedly still there in the Savannah River.
Oh yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
So, but at any rate, and there was one in North Carolina, not that they found they found like back in the 90s or early 2000s. But at any rate, so it wasn't going to do us any good. They figured out at some point, you know. Nuclear bombs got to the point where they were like, okay, this is not going to help. These kids are all going to be gone. We're all of us. This town is going to be completely wiped out.
Shout out to our audience. If anybody else had a parent or a grandparent or a relative involved in nuclear testing, radio, radar, if anyone's listening and you've done any research or you had a relative in that and you want research, please get in touch with me because I spent 4 years nonstop researching exactly that, the technology of World War II, the radio, the radar, the microwaves.
Yeah, you need to talk to Al and Rick and Ordy and Jeff. They like that kind of stuff. But at any rate, so the whole point of this whole conversation is it doesn't matter what we had to go through. It doesn't matter. These kids are going through this now and like telling them that, you know, oh, well, here's my senior picture. Eat your heart out. This is my cap and gown. You're not going to get one. Ha, ha, ha. That's not very nice. That doesn't help, does it, Aggie?
No, it doesn't. And it was like, I asked her, How is this supporting them? Shouldn't we like try to open up areas so that we can like sponsor maybe small parties, small get togethers for them to enjoy? Wouldn't that be supporting them?
Yeah, it would.
And she's like, oh, but that's so dangerous. I said, oh, okay, fine. I get it. I told her straight out, and this was not very nice of me, and I'll probably end up in confession. Once confessions opens back up, I'm going to be in confession for about 5 hours. But I told her, isn't this a little bit like selfie whoring right now? Well, you just don't understand because you don't like putting your old pictures up because, you know, you weren't that pretty and blah, blah, blah. And I'm going, okay, I hit a nerve.
A little bit. Yeah. I think maybe you did. But, but still, I get your point and I think you're right. It's probably not the best way to support kids that are missing out on their graduation. Offer to hold a not Zoom video call for them.
Yes,
anything but Zoom video call.
That was another thing that we discussed in another group was a lot of the volunteers at the high school wanted to do something for the graduating seniors, and so they wanted to do a thing with Zoom and everything, and I put the little bug in their ear to say, hey, maybe not Zoom. Zoom is not really secure and all that stuff. So they switched out of Zoom and they're doing something else. I don't remember.
Yay,
what it was,
but Aggie.
But I have contributed to something around here. I'm proud of myself.
I mean, the Pentagon banned Zoom too.
The funny thing was, and I can tell you this because I know somebody that actually works for the military, they were using Zoom up until maybe last week.
Mm-hmm.
And I had told her specifically, you should not be using Zoom if you're in a military installation or dealing with the POD or in any capacity with the government. And she was like, but why? And I said,
China is asshole.
Yeah, just trust me on this. You do not want Zoom is bad.
Well, and just all you have to do is Google Zoom exploit. That's all you need to do. It's all out there on the internet. It's not like it's hard to find. Zoom exploit. Just Google it. Anywho, and speaking of Google, Google Hangouts is better than Zoom, and I'm not a big fan of Google Hangouts.
Somebody's getting something to drink.
Yeah, cut it out, Vod.
Oh, stop it.
So
is there vodka involved?
Maybe.
There probably is. Not fair. So
it's mostly seltzer.
Right. Yeah.
Mostly the quotation marks.
Yeah. Also telling the kids, oh, well, we went through this or we went doesn't matter. This is 2020. This is 2020, and they're going through this now. So have a little empathy. Have a little sympathy. You know, tell the kids you're sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry you're having to do this. That's enough.
Or honestly, just take a moment. And this is more for the schooler people, of which I have just recently become. And if you know me at all, you will know why that is a very, very bad idea. But now, apparently, I am an entire school building full of teachers in my house. And that's another show. But, you know, if you're homeschooling or you have kids or whatever, you got to take a moment to just be like, you just got to look at them and go, this is fucking weird, right? You know what I mean? You have to just give them the stage for a minute to be like, yeah, this is fucking weird. Like, I was looking forward to all this crap that we were supposed to do. And now, mid-March, we stopped going to school. And now we're not going back to school for the whole year. And all the shit that I was looking forward to. You got to give them that moment to express how they feel. Because they're feeling it. And we may be like, well, we went through worse. Because I've seen people say it. We went through so much worse. Okay, but you know what? You didn't have your senior year stolen from you. You didn't have the whole world shut down in the middle of your school year, and our kids have.
So here's my thing. The extent to which
I'm not that nice to kids, but I'm having a month of
I know and I get that, but here's my thing. I'm not judging anybody for this because I totally get it. I have my moments. I've been there too. The extent to which adults are whining over all this, and I don't blame you. I've done some whining too. I get it. Everybody has a reason to whine. Everybody should feel like they can whine. But if the adults are whining, by God, let the kids whine a little bit too.
Absolutely. Because
this is their childhood. This is their childhood.
Exactly.
Yeah. So anyway.
And we forget that. As adults, we forget that sometimes.
Right.
And we're like, okay, we're not living in a box, a refrigerator box under a bridge in San Francisco with poop and needles. We forget that because we're adults and we've been through bullshit. But so for me,
right. We've all been through bullshit, but this is their chance. This is them going through this now. Let's let them go through it. Now, this is my opportunity to whine. Okay. So I'm going to whine a little bit right now.
Go on, girl.
I am so sick of all the armchair experts who never thought or knew or experienced anything like this, and just in a matter of like a week or two, most of them in the media, right? Okay, so we can whine about the media and bitch about the media all we want to. Most of them in the media. Overnight, it's like they all have a PhD in epidemiology now.
Oh, yeah.
Data science.
And they're all
some
lawyers,
shit that they have. They have no, absolutely no clue about, except for now they're experts on it. Like overnight, all of a sudden, Jim Acosta is overnight an expert in epidemiology and foreign policy.
And every other asshat on Twitter is like, oh, I read an article, so now I know exactly. Like, no, you don't.
I did some research. Yeah.
I read two articles, okay. So now I know more than Fauci and Bricks and Burks, whatever.
Right.
It's seriously, people got to stop with this.
Right. And like,
you know, I know I have a virologist in the family. There's, you know, I have people in the medical industry on both sides, and I mean, they're like, they're freaking out about the whole, you know, Twitter experting that's going on. And,
yeah.
And they don't understand. It's like, well, that's people are like that.
And some of it is revisionist, right? It's like, look at all these things that happened that never actually happened. And, you know, look at all these things that are that never actually were. And, you know, but China racist. China virus racist.
Yeah, no.
I mean, it's just like, It's insane.
I love people that are like, that just grab on to a mainstream media story. Oh my God, it's from a guy eating bat soup. If you had any sort of a brain, and I'm not shitting on people, but even with my limited... It's not that limited, but with my experience, I'm not a virologist, I'm not a biologist, I'm not a lawyer, but my experience in all of these fields was like, yeah, this virus thing has some hallmarks that lend itself to being probably created, man-made guy ate bat soup. And people are like, no, it came from bat soup or whatever. It's like, you need to open your mind a little more and not just rush to judgment on whatever.
It's okay to have an opinion. It's okay to have an opinion. It's okay to have an opinion about what happened.
Right.
But it's,
you
it's
have these
not
people
okay.
that insist they're right.
It's not okay to be judgmental and Anyway, it's okay to have an opinion. It's okay to express whatever you want to express. But it's okay for me to think that you're a know-it-all wannabe expert when you really don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
Having an opinion.
It's okay. It's okay for me to think that. And I think that about a lot of fucking people on Twitter.
Having an opinion is one thing. Presenting what your opinion is as fact and insisting that you are the sole resource for that, that's where people go wrong.
Well, yeah, but it's still like, a free country. It's still a free country. It's still okay. It's still legal. It's still legal for you to do that. But it's also legal for me to call you a stupid, fucked up, wannabe expert that doesn't know what the fuck they're talking about. It's okay for me to say that.
At the end of the day, the whole thing of that is just because you can doesn't mean you should, in terms of just because you read a Breitbart article or Daily Kos or whatever piece of information you grab onto and think is capital T truth, doesn't mean you should.
Yeah.
You should
leave your mind open. And so Mike says, I hate all these millionaire Hollywood actors on TV. But this reminds me of, like, and I'll just tell this story real quick. Forrest Gump's wife, Tom Hanks' wife, said about taking hydrochloroquine.
Rita Wilson.
Yeah, taking hydrochloroquine. And she had all these side effects, and it's not safe. But
you know the symptoms.
Yeah. Her side effects were the symptoms of COVID-19. So, I mean, it was really stupid, and it's like, I'm a movie star, so I get to take this drug, but you shouldn't take it because it's not safe.
Oh my God, I had side effects. No, you had the flu, then you took the drugs, and you're not dead.
Yeah,
so
you had the woo.
Fuck up.
Yeah, you had the woo flu, and you're still alive, and so you need to shut the fuck up, right? And not only that, it shortens the sickness itself. So while she might have had it for 14 days, she ended up having it for what, like 5 or 6, maybe. I mean, I think that the it's a 10-day cycle of dosage on the drug. So it's like, okay, you might have had it for a whole nother week and been sick for a whole nother week, except that you took this drug. Shut up,
you know
up,
what, Rita
woman.
Wilson, you're not dead. You're not dead.
Yeah.
So shut the fuck
just
up.
Shut up, Rita. Just shut up.
Being grateful. Is
do
not
some more periscopes
that very
from your weird,
yeah, exactly.
From your weird basement.
No, Aggie, exactly. Being grateful and gracious, they have no clue about it.
Mm.
No, they don't. And I think they have taken it for granted for so long.
Yeah,
that it escapes them. I mean, I remember this was years and years and years ago, and this was in Puerto Rico, but a very famous Puerto Rican actor actually was in a horrible car accident. And they thought that he might not be able to walk anymore. And he ended up having surgeries, and he ended up going through physical therapy and everything. And he was able to walk again, but he couldn't, he didn't move the way he used to. I mean, he still had the limp and all that stuff. And I remember him saying something to the effect that he was grateful for that limp. And I didn't understand it at the time. I thought he was like whack when he said that. But I understand.
He was grateful because he was alive, right?
He was alive. Mm-hmm. And he was grateful that he had that reminder to appreciate life.
I know that
feel. You know, and for him, I mean, it completely changed his outlook. He used to be hard drunk womanizing ass, and after that, I mean, he was like flying the straight and narrow and whatnot, and he became an advocate for a lot of charities and stuff. I mean, he turned his entire life around, and that is somebody that actually became grateful for what the gift of life that was given to him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't see that often over here. I'm sorry to say, I don't see it very often.
When you have a brush with dying, it gives you a different perspective on life. And I've had that happen twice in the last 5 years, or no, wait, 10 years, whatever it is. I don't remember. But like, I've been through that twice in the last decade or so. It gives you a different perspective. Not always like, oh, I'm so appreciative. Now I'm going to go save all the cats and dogs and homeless people. But it does something to you. It changes you.
It does. Anybody that actually has an appreciation for life and what, you know, and begins to actually live it in a better way has,
you know, in a coping way.
Yes, even that. The thing is, you know, most of these people just take what they have for granted. And it is really sad to see. I'm not saying that they're necessarily bad people. I just think that they're skewed, you know?
We all end up needing a bitch slap to wake us the fuck up sometimes. Like, no matter who you are, no matter what your situation is, there's always a thing that can happen that's like smack and it wakes you up, you know? And it's how you deal with it and where you go with it that makes all the difference.
Indeed.
Yep. So, So I did the list last week for Kill Mary Bang. So,
oh my God.
Yeah. So I think that you need to do the list this week, Aggie.
All right. I will take it. Oh, sorry. Okay. No, Aggie.
No. Let Vodka take it.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. You do it, Vod.
All right, I'm going in a totally different direction. So, Brad Pitt, Paul Rudd. Oh, the guys are going to hate this. Wait, let me start over.
Okay.
So, we'll go with Paul Rudd, Angelina Jolie, and Billy Crystal. Not Bill Crystal, that piece of shit. Billy Crystal, the funny comedian.
Okay.
How do you like that?
You first, Aggie.
Boy, howdy. Oh, boy. Mary, I would probably marry... I'd marry Bill Crystal. Billy Crystal. I gotta have a guy that will make me laugh, and that's assured. That's assured. Let's see.
I shouldn't have tossed a chick in the mix. Can I swap her out for somebody else?
Please do.
Yeah. All right. I'm sorry. I wasn't even thinking. All right. Jim Brewer. So Paul Rudd, Jim Brewer.
Okay, wait. Who's Jim Brewer?
Oh, come on.
He's Saturday Night Live. He's another comedian.
All right, Paul Rudd, Lindsey Graham, and Jim, Bill Crystal.
Oh, God. Okay.
We should have prepped this earlier, you guys. Anyway.
It's more fun when we don't prep it.
Obviously, I would sleep with Paul Rudd. I would probably... I can't kill any one of the three.
I know, I'm sorry. It was a shitty list.
Okay, well, I can kill Paul Rudd because he annoys the fuck out of me. So I can kill him.
Okay.
But Lindsay, I'm not sure he's into girls. So
you'd marry him, right?
I suppose I would. I mean, he's a Southern boy. At least we probably eat the same food and drink the same liquor.
I would have to revise it, Lindsay.
And from time to time, he does make me laugh. So that leaves me marrying Billy Crystal, who has tons of money. So that'd be fine.
I feel like we need to come up with a better list than F, marry, kill. Maybe like drink with. Or party with, bang.
That's so much less fun.
Right.
So much less fun. All right, we got to get out of here. So I'm going to do this real quick so we can get out of here on time, or otherwise we won't be able to. So Auntie Vodka, you can find on Twitter at Real Auntie Vodka. Sometimes she's with us on the Red Wine on Wednesday night, which I produce here on KLRN at 9 o'clock. You can find me Monday nights on KLRN here at 10 o'clock with my boys, Ordy and Jeff, doing Cyber Wars. And I'm Cyber Word Podcast on Twitter, and Aggie is at Aggie the Barkeep on Twitter, and she is also on at 9 o'clock on Tuesday night with either LL or sometimes Martini Shark sits in, Brad, and then every other week she has He Said, She Said, which is a new show with, what's his name, Mickey.
And, Mickey Blowtorch.
Yeah, Mickey Blowtorch, who's also on Twitter, and it's really funny. And thanks you guys for coming tonight. We really...
Can we do a quick shout-out to Loftus?
Yeah, Loftus
started tonight.
I'm trying to get out of here because another show is on next. Loftus is on Fox Nation tonight. Catch Loftus. And thanks, you guys. We love you. We're out.
Peace.
Good night. I dance around.